JBN, we keep you informed. Unidentified man killed during confrontation with cops in Clarendon. The Independent Commission of Investigations, Indicom, has launched a probe into the fatal shooting of a man by the police in Ebony Park, Clarendon, on Monday. The deceased is yet to be identified. Preliminary reports are that the police team went to a property and an altercation developed between them and the man. The police then reportedly opened fire, hitting the man. He was later pronounced dead at hospital. The police reported recovering an illegal firearm and 10 live rounds of ammunition from the deceased man. One killed, three injured following crash in St. James. 19-year-old Shane Dixon of Cascade District in Hanover died as a result of injuries he received in a motor vehicle collision on the Unity All Main Road in St. James yesterday. Three other persons were also injured in the incident. The Anchovy police report that about 2:35 a.m., the driver of a Toyota Isis motor car who was traveling from Montego Bay, St. James towards Hanover, allegedly lost control of the vehicle. The vehicle then overturned. The police were summoned and four persons were taken to the hospital. Dixon, a passenger, was pronounced dead. The driver of the vehicle was admitted in serious condition, while the other two passengers were admitted for treatment. Three men charged over Mullines Road hostage situation. The police have charged the three men who were taken into custody following the hostage situation at a business establishment on Mullines Road, St. Andrew, earlier this month. Charged are 29-year-old Dwayne Wellington, a fabricator of Olympic Way Kingston 11, 27-year-old Junior Brown, otherwise called Rumpel, of Tambourine Avenue, Kingston 10, and a 33-year-old Simeon Forbes of Mullines Road, St. Andrew. They are charged with kidnapping, assault with intent to rob, illegal possession of firearm, and illegal possession of ammunition. It is reported that the men were attempting to rob a woman of monies, which was a property of a business establishment, when the robbery attempt was foiled by police who intervened. After several hours of negotiation by the police, Wellington and Brown surrendered. The hostages were not harmed. Forbes was later apprehended by the police. The men are to appear before the gun court on Friday, September 27. JUTC resuming operations with security on board. The Jamaica Urban Transit Company, JUTC, says its buses are operating on selected routes with security personnel on board after the company's drivers withdrew their services yesterday over the killing of one of their colleagues. "We are on the road again. We are phasing in our rollout and selective routes. Buses have been dispatched from our Spanish Town and Portmore depots. Security on board," the JUTC tweeted this morning. JUTC buses have also been seen operating on routes in Kingston and St. Andrew. In a statement late yesterday evening, the state-run bus company said it would enhance security across its operations following the killing of its employee and a taxi operator. Managing Director of the JUTC, Paul Abrahams, said the staff at the Rockford Depot are tense and fearful. "One can understand their unwillingness to go out, given that the driver who was killed was from this depot. We'll be providing counseling support in addition to staff bus protection in the hope that this situation will quickly come to a resolution. Consequently, we anticipate that Portmore and the Spanish Town drivers will show up for the resumption of service," Abrahams added. In addition, some 40 police officers, along with private security guards, have been deployed to strategic locations to provide static duty. These include, but are not limited to, the Halfway Tree Transport Center, North Odeon Avenue, Downtown, Papin to Halfway Tree, Chancery Street, and North and South Parades, the JUTC said. The bus company's corporate communications manager, Cecil Toms, said there is still a palpable fear amongst drivers, and we continue to assuage fears so that they will show up tomorrow. We'll continue to do all we can to resume full service to our commuters. St. Richard's in shock as teacher recovers from attack, dogs put down in aftermath. Three of four pit bulls implicated in a vicious attack in which a St. Andrew teacher was pinned down for hours last Thursday have been euthanized. The fourth dog, a puppy, was spared as the Jamaica Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, which has assisted the police in recovering the animals 2 days after the attack, carried out the procedure. The grade 6 teacher at St. Richard's Primary School was reportedly attacked by the dogs late evening last Thursday in a section of Cooper's Hill, St. Andrew, while exercising. She was rescued nearly 3 hours later when a police officer who arrived on the scene fired a shot scaring off the dogs. Attempts by citizens to free her from the mauling had proved futile. They watched in horror as the dog sat upon the woman, inflicting several bite wounds and licking her blood. Yesterday, a somber mood was pervasive at St. Richard's as students and staff tried to process their grief. The teacher is still recovering in hospital, and we have been informed that she is recuperating well and her injuries are not life-threatening. She was allowed visits at the hospital yesterday for the first time since leaving the intensive care unit, according to a source at the school. The source also said that much of the swelling on different parts of her body has begun to subside. Yesterday, counselors were on hand helping staff and students at St. Richard's to process the attack. They declined to speak as they were still reeling from shock. Among those providing intervention and support to the distressed school community were representatives of St. Richard's Roman Catholic Church, as well as Carl Samuda and a team from the Education Ministry, which he is overseeing. Samuda is also a member of Parliament of St. Andrew North Central, in which the school is situated. The police also sent a team from the Community Safety and Security Branch. Debbie Meeks, a teacher at Calabar High School, who knows the grade 6 teacher well, expressed relief that her colleague was able to survive the attack. She's just so calm, quiet, humble, and peaceful. And to hear this has happened to her is heart-wrenching. It tears us up as a group because we can't imagine her lying there for hours with dogs just mauling her and there's no help. As a friend, it is painful, Meeks said. Jamaica Teachers Association President Owen Speed expressed concern that with the government's push to have more people exercising with his Jamaica Moves campaign, a teacher could be attacked in her community while on her fitness routine. One of the most fundamental things is that the Ministry of Health is promoting the Jamaica Moves program in schools. Teachers will carry that from the schools into their communities. If teachers or anybody else can't walk freely on the roads, then that is something we have to look at, he said. Speed also called for a ban on citizens owning pit bulls and other dogs considered dangerous. If a law is here that bans them, the animals should not be here. They should find a way to make them extinct. Private owners should not have those dogs. If it is a security company, then fine, he said during his visit to St. Richard's. Although he claims to love dogs, attorney-at-law Peter Champagny, who was himself attacked roughly 6 years ago by a pit bull, explained that only the importation of the animals is on the law books as an offense. We should not move away from the discussion without recognizing that dogs are important. The more I meet people is the more I love dogs. What is illegal is the importation of that breed. But prior to the ban, we had pit bulls here. People also mix the pit bulls with other big breed dogs, he said. I was attacked by a pit bull and I had to receive surgery overseas to save my hand from becoming deformed. The Dog Liabilities Act that came about in the 1800s is very short and doesn't deal with, for instance, the management of dogs considered to be dangerous. The legislation doesn't speak to any onus on the owner to care for the dogs. Champagne explained that there are no guidelines mandating an owner to have a certain height of fencing or a leash for the dog when on the road. He revealed that dog trainers are not required to be registered and there are no standards governing trainer competence. There's nothing to suggest that there are restricted areas and you cannot be walking your dog in an area where it is crowded and is not properly managed, and so on. In recent times, there has been discussion about a re-examination and overhaul of old legislation to bring them up to date. This is one that is deserving of attention. Allowing a situation where owners of dogs are mandated to treat them, manage them, and care for them in a particular way, the attorney said. Williams may withdraw from World Champs team. Dr. Emir Crowne, the legal representative of sprinter Briana Williams, says his client is considering voluntarily withdrawing from Jamaica's team to the IAAF World Championship, which start on Friday in Doha, Qatar. While the team is now in the Middle East getting ready for the 9-day event, Williams has been in Jamaica attending her anti-doping hearing versus the Jamaica Ant1-D0ping Commission for a positive test returned with traces of the banned substance, hydrochlorothiazide. The hearing, which started on Monday, ended on Tuesday afternoon, a day ahead of schedule. But independent anti-doping disciplinary panel chairman Kent Gammon says the decision will be announced at a date which he did not specify. Crowne says he and his client had anticipated an expedited announcement which would allow her time to travel and prepare for the 100-meter event, which starts on Friday. But now Crowne says since a decision is not forthcoming, his team or the IAAF may have to make an emergency appeal to the Court of Arbitration for Sport in Switzerland yesterday for a solution. We're hoping for a decision, or at least some commitment for a decision in advance of Thursday, but the panel won't commit to that. And quite frankly, it leaves us in a bad spot, Crowne told reporters at the conclusion of the hearing on Tuesday afternoon. Now, where we are is, Ms. Williams withdraws, which begrudgingly she has agreed to do, because we wouldn't want to end up in a situation that has happened in recent past where an athlete, after the fact, gets an anti-doping violation and Jamaica's relay medals are stripped from them. So Ms. Williams is actually willing to voluntarily withdraw. JBN, we keep you informed. Please remember to like, subscribe, share, leave us a comment and click the notification bell to receive our daily news items.